Let's say Walt Disney's fondest memories came from a small town in Missouri where he lived with his family, a town called Marceline.
If you ask me now what makes a man the place where he comes from, religion, his family, and his friends. Indeed, these all must play a role, and any can for some, but for Walt there was just one in the end. Marceline, Marceline, where the best of dreamers dream, though you've given me your best, I must be heading west. Though I owe so much to you, I must do as dreamers do. My city, my queen, Marceline. Where the best of dreamers dream, will you give me your best? I must be heading west. Though I owe so much to you, I must do as dreamers do. My city, my queen, Marceline.
Here comes the Disney family now. You see, Walt's parents, Elias and Flora, decided to buy a farm and move to the country. They didn't feel safe in Chicago anymore. It was the place where Walt was born, but the turn of the century brought with it a rise in crime. This boy, named after the family's local pastor, was unlike anyone America had ever seen. They just didn't know it yet. And Flora and Elias certainly didn't know it, but moving their family to this little town in Missouri would change American history.
Hey, first and foremost, let's give thanks to God for getting us here safe.
Amen.
Amen. Roy, go to the luggage cart and get our bags and trunks. Walt, I need you to go find Mr. Kaufman, his horse and buggy. Laura, can you get some water for my canteen, please? Walt! Walter! Walter!
No one could have imagined that what Walt was seeing would end up being such a big inspiration to him later in life. Walt's eyes had just witnessed their first glimpse at what really was Main Street, USA.
Wow. Walter!
Yes, sir.
Are you ready to see the farm?
Yes, sir.
All right, my absent-minded son. Try to keep up with Roy.
Come on, Walt. There's my other wagon here to meet us. See, people are real nice here.
I think I'm going to like it here, Roy.
You haven't even seen the farm yet.
I can already tell. It already smells a lot nicer, people are a lot nicer, and the sky's a lot nicer.
Come on, Walt.
Walt Disney was known to say that more things and importance happened to him in Marceline than had happened since or were likely to in the future.
What do you think, Ruth? Boy, this is the life.
Life?
No, I mean, ain't it pretty?
Pretty.
It's not the city, get it? This here's the country.
Country.
Golly, can't you come up with anything on your own? Oh, brother.
Sister.
Even through cold winter, Walt would find a way to entertain himself and his family. You see, Walt was interested in the arts and adventures from a very young age. And, well, it looks as if he's about to create his first masterpiece.
Look, Ruth, paint.
Huh?
Don't worry, Ruth. It comes off. It's just paint. All we need now is paintbrushes.
Now, Walt, she doesn't know any better, but you should.
I'm sorry, Mama. It was there, and I just figured...
Well, sorry isn't going to take the pitch off the side of my house now, is it?
I thought you'd like it. We made it for you, like real-life painters.
Real painters use real paint, Walt.
I'm sorry. I thought...
Oh, Walt. Ooh, what am I going to do with you? Your imagination is just bursting at the seams.
I can paint the rest of the house so it matches. I think I'll kind of look nice.
Don't you dare. Now, Walter, I know you didn't mean anything by it, but you're gonna have to be punished. I can't let you go around getting away with things like this. You understand?
I'm sorry, Mama. I'm so sorry. Please don't punish Ruth. It was my fault, not hers. I told her it would wash off. I thought it was like real paint.
Well, you can paint the fence to make up for it. How's that?
Okay, Mama.
With real paint this time.
Just like Tom
Sawyer. Walt had a big heart for the kid, and it was filled with dreams. Why, he even found a dreaming tree in Marceline. It was his own special place, where he could sit and imagine all sorts of magical things. He would return to this spot throughout his adult life for reflection, prayer, and of course, to be inspired. He was proud of that tree and the dreams that came from it. And if the dreaming tree wasn't working out for Walt's awake dreaming, it sure came in handy as a spot for some real dreaming, like the sleeping kind.
Walter, wake up and see what Auntie Margaret's brought you.
Auntie Margaret, is that you?
No, just a dream, silly.
If you're just a dream, haven't you brought me something I've been dreaming about?
Am I not present enough?
I suppose.
Walt, that's why you're my favorite nephew, honest as the day you were born. Of course I have presents for you. Look.
A new tablet, new art supplies, the whole lot?
All of it.
All for me?
Yes, be my guest. Help yourself.
Oh, thank you, Auntie. Thank you.
You can thank me by drawing me a picture, Walt. You are such a grand artist. I'm going to see your work in a museum one day.
Well, today I promised Doc Sherwood that I'd draw Rupert.
Who is Rupert?
His horse.
I suppose you have to start somewhere. Maybe afterwards you could draw a picture for me, too? But only if you have all your chores done first, all right?
Right after I get done with Rupert. Look, there he is now with Doc.
Well, run along.
Thank you, Margaret.
Did I just get snubbed for a horse?
Sorry. Do you think you can still draw him while he's acting this way? Perhaps he's just being shy or something.
I've almost got it, I think.
Say, Walter... How's your father feeling these days? I've heard that he's been ill.
Well, he's doing pretty awful, Doc.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, Walter. Should I pay him a visit, you think?
No, sir. If he even finds out that I was talking about him, please don't, Doc. Mom says it's just stress that's done to him. He's made himself sick by worrying so much about everything. I think it's just the weather, or at least that's what Auntie Margaret says.
Well, either way, it's understandable. He's got a big farm to tend. Just making ends meet. It seems like he may have to give it up.
Oh, no, sir. We all love the farm. Heck, what would Marceline be without Walt Disney? Right, Doc?
Well, it certainly wouldn't be as colorful, but... Well, as much as Rupert and I would hate to see you go, well, sometimes in life you have to give up things you love. It just makes sense to move on.
I'm not going anywhere, Doc. This here's my home.
Well, home is where the heart is, as they say, Walter.
Well, my heart is in Marceline.
Well, I know that, Walter. I know, but, well, perhaps you should begin to think about...
Excuse me, sir. I hate to be short with you, but I've got other pictures to get to. Here we go. All done.
I love it. It's magnificent. What a talented young man you are, Walter.
Gee, thanks, Doc. It wasn't easy with Rupert dancing the whole time. It was fun, though, trying to get him on paper. With the way he moved, well, being still would have been too easy.
Well, it's exceptional. I'd like to frame it and put it in my house.
Really?
Yes, really. Oh, now, here's a nickel. Now, I think that's a fair exchange, if you'll agree, of course.
Wow, Doc, I would just give it to you.
Never give your art away, Walt. No, talent like this needs to be paid for. I've never seen a patient for free, now have I? Exactly. If you're going to be a real artist, you're going to have to charge for your work.
To everybody? Even my mom?
Not everyone, but the general public, yeah.
Okay. Then maybe Maybe just my dad.
Oh, and Walter, if you're going to be a real artist, you're going to have to leave Marceline eventually. I mean, real artists need adventure in their lives. It's inspiration for their work, you see.
I guess so.
Mm-hmm. You need to see new things, meet new people, new horses even. Fill your mind full of fresh creativity. You need to do that, though, away from Marceline. The artists of today are in New York City. Or maybe even France.
Well, right now, I'm just happy to own Rupert.
An artist goes where the wind blows, Walter.
I'll think about that, Doc. I better get home for dinner so I can draw Auntie Margaret's picture first. And I'm awful grateful for the nickel, Doc. I'll remember this forever. Thank you.
Oh, you're very welcome, Walter. And whenever I look at this picture, I'll think of you. Well, goodbye now, son.
Returns.
Look, and Margaret, I made a whole nickel. I sold my first artwork.
Of a horse?
Yeah, and I kept dancing around like I was doing the foxtrot, too.
Walter, you amaze me more every day. You sold your first sketch? You are a real artist now.
Well, not real. I'm still just a kid. I have to wait until I'm older.
Well, is that what you want to be when you grow up, an artist?
Well, yeah, but I want to be something more.
Like what? The President of the United States?
Well, not my president in politics. I want to have the power to change people's lives somehow.
Well, art changes people's lives, Walter.
How?
Art has power. It has the power to make us happy or sad. It has the power to help us see things differently. Or we see something and we feel it too, and it helps us know we're not alone. Art can challenge people. It can change people.
Wow, that's what I want to do.
Well, you are off today making magnificent start.
And if I can get paid to do it, well, Doc said I shouldn't give away my art for free.
Well, you have to listen to your heart on that one. But you have to listen to your stomach, too, because a man has to eat, and it takes money to buy food. Speaking of which, we had better head in for dinner before your dad sends out a search party.
Yeah. And Auntie Margaret?
Yes.
These are for you. Oh,
Walter, beautiful. They look so real I can almost smell them. Thank you.
No, thank you, Auntie Margaret.
For what?
You're the only adult that talks to me like I'm a real person.
Well, you are a real person. I think. I mean, aren't you?
Of course I am. You know what I mean, Auntie Margaret.
I know what you mean. We are kindred spirits.
Yes, kindred spirits.
And if there was another adult Walt enjoyed being around as much as his Auntie Margaret, it was his Uncle Mike, the steam train engineer. Ever since he took that first train ride when he arrived at the station in Marceline, he was hooked. He even said himself that one of the prides of his life was his Uncle Mike Martin, who was an engineer on a train running from Marceline to Fort Madison, Iowa. After all, if you can't be an engineer yourself, the next best thing is to have a relative who is one. And young Walt was expecting him any minute.
Say there, guy. What you doing on the tracks? Don't you know there's a train coming?
Why, sure I do, mister. That train coming is engineered by my very own uncle, Mr. Mike Martin.
That so?
Sure is. Wait and see.
Well, could you wait and see from up here? You're making me a bundle of nerves sitting on the track like that. I don't want to end up in the Marceline Herald as the man who ignores track-napping kid just before he was squished.
Ah, shucks, mister. I'm just listening for the train is all.
Listening for the train? Ain't that why a train blows its whistle?
Gosh, mister. Haven't you ever listened for the vibrations on a track? You can hear a train coming from miles away.
No fooling, huh?
You want to try? Well, golly, you're afraid, are you?
Who, me? Oh, I'm not afraid. I've been meaning to brush up on my train vibration studies. Like this? I don't hear anything.
Patience is a virtue.
I hear something!
That's my Uncle Mike.
Wow, that really is a swell trick.
A real try, mister.
Oh, shucks. Thanks, kid. I don't always know
hope the trains are running on time.
Mister?
What's that, kid?
My skedaddle.
Walt's love for trains was only rivaled by his love for community and marshalling. There was no doubt that Walt felt a sense of support from his relative. His father, Elias, may not have ever fully understood his son, but he would reluctantly support Walt. And you see, marshalling was a place where people helped each other. One of Walt's favorite memories of such a time was threshing season. A steam engine would pull a train of wagons throughout the fields, and all the neighbors would gather around to be of service. They were good Christian people, helping one another survive. As Walt would later put it, I believe firmly in the efficacy of religion, in its powerful influence on a person's whole life. It helps immeasurably to meet the storms and stresses of life and keep you attuned to divine inspiration. Without inspiration, we would perish. All I ask of myself, live a good Christian life. And so he did. He learned a lot about how to live, about his own character, all from Marceline and the people that lived there. And he would keep those qualities in his heart to forever be a part of him. Walt sure wished that things never had to change. He wished it more than anything. But he knew Doc Sherwood was right. Sometimes you have to give things up. And as much as he didn't want to, he could tell that change was coming. And he knew their life in Marceline couldn't last forever. Except for in his heart, of course. Nobody could ever take that from him. But it wouldn't be long before Flora made the decision to sell the farm and move into town. Now sure, the town wasn't far, but to Walt, it might as well have been a whole world away. Once he got a taste of that country life, boy, he didn't want to give it up. But soon, it wouldn't be a choice.
Roy?
Yeah?
Why do you think Dad's having us polish this stuff now? The farming season's over, and it's just gonna get all dusty again. So, why?
Oh, come on, Walt. You know why.
Yeah. I guess I just wanted to hear it from somebody who tell it to me straight.
Just as long as we're together, it'll be business as usual.
It'll be different, Roy, and you know it.
Gosh, I'm only trying to cheer you up. And I meant it. Most of it, anyway. We may not be here on the farm, but we'll still have each other. It's just time to move on is all. But the whole world's ahead of us. It's time to get off this farm.
You wanna leave, Marceline?
Doesn't anything make you feel better, Walt?
Walter, what's this I hear about you feeling bad?
I just don't want...
Don't what?
He wants to stay. I can't blame him.
Boys, I'm sorry, but in this household, we gotta go wherever we can make the better life for ourselves, not wherever we can draw the best barn cap. Now, how's the polishing coming? It'll be a fate worse than death if this isn't ready for the auction tomorrow.
Auction? Tomorrow?
Yeah, auction. What do you think, we're gonna pull this stuff behind the wagon? Take it to the new house? It'd look real good now, sitting there on the street, now wouldn't it?
Oh, Dad, you didn't mean anything by it.
Well, you're not the only one losing something here. I've worked hard for this. All of this.
We know you did, Dad.
Boys, make yourself useful. Go into town, hang these signs up, and I'll work even harder cleaning up the farm equipment. Here, you're finished.
Well, we can do both, Dad.
No, just get it done. Go into town and get it done.
We'll be back.
Boys! Listen, make sure you're home in time for dinner. Your mom's making something really nice. It'd be great to be together as a family.
We're all hurting in our own way. Dad doesn't always show it, but he's hurting. And he cares that we're hurting too.
I don't know.
You'll understand when you get older.
If that's getting older, I don't ever want to get older.
You can't help growing up.
Well, we'll have to see about that.
Oh, yeah?
I have some ideas. Ever heard of the Fountain of Youth? I read about it once in an adventure book.
Oh, Walt.
It's real, I tell ya.
It was a sad day indeed. Everything Walt had come to know was changing, and would just keep on changing, as life has a tendency to do. But he had Roy, and at least Roy could not only support, but enjoy Walt's imagination. The family moved into a small house in town where Elias could get better while Walt, Roy, and Ruth would finish school. Walt actually enjoyed that house. It was cozy, and the family was always together. That he could get used to. School was probably the only thing that remained the same. Even Marceline was changed. Streets were paved now. There were automobiles, a big old movie theater. And just before the family left, there were real electric streetlights. Walt's small town had become a city within itself. You see, nothing was really going to change. But in Walt's heart, the world, he would always remember Marceline and his own life. Years later, in a meeting, he spoke up finally, saying, "That's what it is, the feeling of freedom that the animals and the characters that live out there. That's what you experience when you go out into the country. You escape the everyday world, the strife, and the struggle. You get out where everything is free and beautiful." And so it remained to him. And he held on to that dream, that place where he once lived that he would never forget, especially when the Disney family left Marceline for good. When Elias was well enough, they were off to Kansas City. Another adventure.
Boys, listen up. Hi. Have a job for us.
What is it?
Yeah, Dad, what is it?
Well, it's a paper route.
A paper route? That's a kid's job.
It's anybody's job as long as it pays money, Walter.
What's it pay?
That's more like it, my industrious. On this job, it pays $3 a customer.
How many customers?
650.
On foot?
Yes, on foot.
How many blocks?
20 square blocks.
Say, Dad, I don't want to gum up the works here or nothing, but I can't carry a third of 650 papers. I don't even know what that is, and I'm sure I can't carry it.
Well, that's why I got us carts, Walter.
So how much will we get paid?
You, Roy, will be making a stipend. Walt here will be making an allowance. And I'll be investing Walter's allowance for him.
Say, what do you mean investment? That's not money.
It's better than money for you, Walt. Trust me.
Well, that's an interesting idea, Dad, but I'd rather take the money instead, please.
Walter. Well, I'm sure you would, Walter, but that's not going to happen. You will listen to what I'm going to say. I'll be investing the money. I don't need you wasting all this money on frivolous things like toys and candy and art supplies.
But...
No buts. Listen, we start at 3:30 in the morning.
But I have school.
Well, then you better get up in time to get your paper route finished before school starts or you're going to go hungry.
But I...
No more buts. Lights out. 3:30 in the morning. 3:30.
Gosh, if it wasn't bad enough that he was making me work with no pay, to add to insult and injury, he compared my art supplies to candies and toys.
Oh, come on. You'd probably use your money to buy more shares of the Ozell company. Heck, maybe he'll run the place one day, then you can work from there.
But I don't care about none of that stuff. I want to be an artist, see? I've been drawing all my life. What are you laughing at?
You say like you're 1,000 years old.
I got as much of a chance as anybody.
Let's just try out this paper out thing, okay? It doesn't mean you have to stop drawing.
Okay.
And I can always buy you candies and toys with my money.
I don't want you going all the way to the store on my account, Roy. Why don't you just go ahead and give me the money?
Good night, Walt.
Good night. And Roy, thanks. Good night, Roy.
So you should be working.
Are you Walt's pop?
Yes, I'm Elias Disney.
Very pleased to meet you, sir. Very pleased. I'm Bert Hudson. I own the joint. Walt is an extremely talented kid. Just look at all the people lined up to see his latest masterpiece.
Yeah, I see. Well, he should be working.
Oh, don't worry about that, Mr. Disney. I pay him all right. He gets a free haircut with every picture, and when he doesn't need a trim, I pay him 15 cents for each work of art.
15 cents?
Oh, you betcha. I frame him right here. I can't get him to draw fast enough. Your son is a hit.
A hit? Walter, why didn't you tell me about this?
I meant to. I just didn't get the chance yet.
Well, he certainly wasn't hiding it out of shame. This is the kind of thing a parent boasts and beams about. Your son is a star in this neighborhood.
All finished, Bert. Hope you like it.
Oh, it's a beaut, Walt. One of your finest. See you in a couple days to draw another? The people keep asking for him.
Sure, Bert. If it's okay with my dad.
Sure, Walt. As long as you deliver your papers on time.
Of course.
Mr. Hudson, he'll be back.
Well, nice to meet you, Mr. Disney. We'll see you soon, Walt.
See ya.
Show me this drawing.
He's mannequin, Master Disney.
Indeed, Walter. What he said.
What did you say?
I have no idea. I just felt that young Master Disney deserved a compliment in a different language. I have no idea what language that was.
Thanks, Oscar. Thanks, Jen.
Walter, did you just call this man Jen?
No. Not Jen. Perhaps you heard young Walter say Jim.
Or Tim.
Or Tom.
Although, Jim would be best.
I think so, but only if it was the tiniest drop in a tall glass of tonic water being sipped in front of a super bella.
Fragile, mystic, especially all ferocious.
Walt Disney. Illustration.
Exactly. Nothing better.
See, young Master Disney, your work is unfit for plain old words.
Someday, people will stare at your work and just not have words. So they'll invent them, or you will, because you're that good.
Walter, please don't encourage him.
Oh, we don't need any encouragement. We've got enough motivational oomph. Yes, we've got enough motivational oomph of our own, just like Walt here.
Motivational oomph. I like the sound of that.
See, just being around you makes people more oofful.
Okay, excuse us, guys. We have to go. Don't you have something else to do?
Why ruin a momentous time? I'm sorry, sir. I don't think you understand. We've known young Master Disney since the beginning.
I don't think you understand. I am young Master Walt's father, and I need to speak with him by myself, if you don't mind.
Father, huh? I guess that kind of trumps our standing with Walter now, doesn't it?
Well, we'll always be outside that window looking at your art, unless nature calls.
Or unless we're looking at your art in a museum.
But it would be his museum, of course, the Disney Museum. He wouldn't share it with anyone.
Walter, you are a true vision artistarian.
Au revoir, young Master Disney.
Here, I made a drawing for you.
Thanks, young Master Disney.
Well, do you guys like it?
Yes, we like it.
I could have done better.
Those guys are pretty funny, huh?
Listen, Mom. You don't need to be spending time with folks like that. You need to be focused on your work and your talent.
You think I'm talented?
The whole neighborhood thinks you're talented, Walt. And now that you're getting paid for your skills, you should invest your earnings.
Oh, Dad.
Now, wait a second. Give me a chance to say something good here.
Sorry, Dad.
You could invest your earnings in art lessons.
They teach at the Kansas City Art Institute.
Well, now that you're becoming an artist, you should look into it. But don't ever think that you're the best. You can always learn something. You can always get better. Do you understand?
Yes, Dad, thank you. I'm going to run home and tell Roy. Meet you there.
Okay, then.
And, Dad?
Yes?
I'm glad you happened by.
Me too, son. Me too.
Nice.
It's electric park. It has games. It has rides. It has everything.
So what's the idea?
We open up our own electric park. Okay? Forget about going to Chicago with Mom and Dad.
Actually, well, I've been meaning to talk to you about something.
No. Look. This place is pretty great, you know. It has stage shows, log rides, a lot of lights, but it's missing something. It's missing imagination. It's missing us. I drew it all out right here. We can open up our own park. A Disney park.
No one is going to come to a Disney park.
Yes, they will. Look, I drew a layout right here.
Hey, enough. Let me speak. This is important.
Well, this sounds serious.
I'm sure it is. I'm going to be leaving in a few weeks.
What do you mean? Where are you going?
I joined the Navy. Yeah, with our country at war, I can't just sit around and do nothing when I know I'm able to help.
What about me?
This is for you. This is for you and every other American in this country. I mean, I'm doing this so that you can continue to live a safe and free life. Don't you get it?
No, I don't get it. I need you here, Roy. What am I going to do without you?
Come on, Walt. Look at you. You're doing great. You're getting paid to draw. You're taking art classes. You're a swell kid, all on your own. You don't need me.
Yeah, I do, Roy. Yeah, I do need you. You're my family.
And I will still be your family no matter where I am. I'm your brother whether I'm sitting next to you or on the other side of the world. Hey, let me put it to you this way. I need an adventure. A real adventure, the kind you read about in history books. You know, the kind that takes you to different parts of the world to see different people, different places. And this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for me to have that adventure. I need you to understand that.
Yeah, I get it. I mean, I get that you're the bravest person I know. And you're the best brother a guy could ask for. And you're the only person around here that understands me and supports me.
I understand, and pretty soon you'll be able to take your own adventures. And, you know, right now, maybe for you, that's Chicago.
Boy, you know, I don't know. Hey, what if I go with you?
You will be with me. I'll be thinking of you the whole time.
Roy, I'll find a way. Okay, I love this country just as much as anybody else. Right, and if you look up close in my eye, you'll see an American flag waving. And up my spine is growing red, white, and blue. All right, I'll find a way, Roy. I'll find a way.
Whatever you say. So, tell me about this Disney park.
It's just an idea. But now, together we're going on a real adventure. The Disney boys are going out to war.
Things didn't move quite as fast as Walt had hoped, and he found himself living in Chicago with Elias and Flora. Chicago was bittersweet for Walt. He got a job as a cartoonist for his school newspaper. He even had a girlfriend. But nothing could make him forget that Laura was gone. He missed his brother, and he was going to find a way to join him. Sometimes in your heart, you just know it's the right thing to do. He'd follow in Roy's footsteps and be as brave as he could. He'd make his brother proud. So Walt figured he'd go ahead and fight for our country. He was going to enlist to fight in World War I, just like Roy did.
Mr. Disney! The United States Army thanks you for your gumption and your courage in approaching the recruitment office today, but...
Well, of course, sir. I mean, it's my duty as an American...
Mr. Disney!
Yes, sir.
At ease, Mr. Disney. Listen, kid, you're 16 years old. Under the Selective Service Law, I can't take you unless you're 18. Got it?
Excuse me, sir, but I think my pride as an American makes up for those years. I mean, my willingness to get out there and fight with a fellow countryman. I mean, I have bravery bursting out of my soul. Doesn't that count for anything?
We appreciate your bravery, but that doesn't mean I can break the rules for you.
Sir, do you have a brother?
Yeah, three of them. What's that got to do with anything, Mr. Disney?
Well, it has a whole lot to do with me, sir. I mean, my brother's out there. My brother's out in the fight. And there's nothing I would want more than to be out there with him. His name's Roy Disney. And he's full of courage and love for America. And I have as much pride for him as this country. I mean, I just want to get out there and show him. Surely you understand that.
I do understand. And in 2 years, I'll be real proud to call you a soldier. But until then, my back's against the wall, kid. Rules are rules. I'm sure you can understand that.
Yes, sir.
Next! Mr. Johnston, you gonna shave?
Now, Walt Disney never took no for an answer. There was this new agency called the Red Cross that helped people. And they were fixing to send some men abroad to help out with the war. And wouldn't you know it? Well, you only had to be 17 years old. Sure, Walt was only 16, but he figured he could squeak by with a little bit of his artistic talent. But when Flora and Elias caught wind of it, well, they were none too happy.
How could you do this, Walt? You were just going to sneak off and not tell us anything? You don't have respect enough for your mother and I to tell us your plans.
I didn't think you'd let me go. It's for our country. It's like what Roy's doing.
And you wanted to march off without even saying goodbye, Walt?
March off to death? Did you know that, Walt? You could die out there. I can't believe you were just going to march off and die and not tell your mother and I anything, not even a letter.
I'm sorry. It's... All I'm thinking about is Roy, and being brave like him.
Well, you're not Roy. Roy can take care of himself out there. Roy has respected my plans for this family all along. He has proven himself to me, Walt. You will never be Roy. You're a different son. You're the dreamer. And Walt, dreamers, they don't fight. I won't have it.
I don't want to fight. I want help. And if you just sign this paper, I can be a member of the Red Cross. I can be a part of the relief effort. Look, I want to aid our country. and protect our liberties as Americans. Don't you understand that?
No, I don't.
I do.
Excuse me?
If we don't sign, he'll just find some other way to go and sneak off. At least this way we can say goodbye to him and have a proper send-off. His mind is set.
I will not sign.
Elias, please, be rational.
Flora, you can do whatever you want. I will not sign my son's death warrant.
Sorry, Mom, I should have told you.
Yes. Yes, you should have. But even if you did, your father wouldn't have allowed it. Still, it would have been the respectful thing to do.
It's just I miss Roy, and I wanted to do something to make him proud. I mean, America's important to this family, and if this is the war to end all wars, they're going to need some dreamers.
It's okay, Walt. I understand. Now, where do I sign?
Welcome to the American Red Cross training facility. You gentlemen are what we like to call the ambulance corps. Preparing for war is an understatement. There are so many disturbing and grotesque things that you will see on the field that you will probably want to run away like girls. But you can't. You have taken a vow to be a part of this corps. You will have to stand your ground in the field and be men. As they say, war is hell. So welcome to hell. Your trucks, your vehicles, will be hosts to thousands of lives, and many of which will be lost depending on your driving abilities. Well, let's just hope and pray that your host doesn't become a ghost host. Welcome to the American Red Cross. Prepare for blood and the French.
Now, Walt had won the battle, but he hadn't won the war. The United States did that without him. But Walt got shipped off to France to be part of the ambulance corps anyway. There were still relief efforts that needed to be taken care of, and it was now his duty to go ahead and take care of them. Now, Walt got to see all sorts of things in France. It was a whole new sort of experience for him. Here, he'd never left the Midwest, and now he was traveling around an awful lot. This small town boy was quickly turning into a man. Time seemed to move slower in France, and it was at this point where Walt was introduced to cigarettes. However, just like when he was a boy under the dreaming tree, he found comfort in art. And just like before, it was on an unlikely canvas.
Action today?
Nope, not today. Not yesterday, not even the day before that. Guess our instructor was right. If boredom is what they mean by hell, war is hell.
Hey, fella, those are some pretty unique funnies you got out there.
Thanks. But when they're in the paper, they're called funnies. When they're that big, it's called art.
Well, art. Do you mind if I show my buddy?
Never minded a bit of publicity in my life.
Sure. Hey, Ray, come here. Check this out. They call this art.
That's nothing. I know a guy back in the East Coast who can know just as good as that. He's dating my sister.
Well, he ain't here, is he?
No, but...
Oh, but nothing. What'd you say your name was again?
I didn't, but it's Disney. Walt Disney.
Well, my name's Jim. This is my buddy, Ray. And, do you think you might be able to, draw a couple of things for our meat wagons?
Well, sure I could. I can draw something for you, your gals, whatever you need. For a nominal fee, of course.
How about a pack of smokes? Make it a carton and they'll draw both your Model Ts. Sold. Jim, let's bring them around.
Doc Sherwood was right so many years ago. Walt needed to see the world. And just like he predicted, France was where much of his art was perfected. But by the time Walt returned home to Kansas City, he was a chain smoker. So naturally, he needed a job to pay for his newfound habit. He had always wanted to be an actor or an artist, but as he put it, it seemed easier to get a job as an artist. Walt was crushed. And who better to turn to for advice Why, Big Brother Roy, of course. Roy had been working at a bank, and Walt rushed right on down to tell his sad tale. A co-worker of Roy's knew about some fellows who ran a commercial art shop called Pessman Rubin. They were looking to hire an apprentice. Roy got Walt an interview, and boy, Walt could have kissed him.
Roy! I love you, brother! Hey, you're welcome. All right, just show up to the interview with your best portfolio, some of the knock-through songs. You'll do the trick, okay? I know you will. Roy Disney, you are the best brother in the whole world! You are the best bank teller in the whole world! It was a pleasure, and you have great staff in this bank. Just... He's an artist.
But not only did Walt land the gig at Pessman Rubin, but at a whopping $50 a month. He always went after his own dream. The dreams he'd had ever since his Auntie Margaret had given him his first art supplies. And she was just the woman Walt wanted to tell about it.
Say, is that your gal? She sure is a looker.
No, she's not my gal. It's my auntie. And yes, she is beautiful, and you should learn to be more polite.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean nothing by it. I was just... She sure is pretty, and I bet she's just as swell, too.
She sure is. I wouldn't be where I am today without her. Where I am today is just the beginning.
Sounds like you're a real lucky guy to have a nice lady like that as your auntie.
Sure am. I'm on my way to tell her that, too.
Wow. She sure is a beaut.
She's not a racehorse, fella. All right? Would you talk to your mother with a mouth like that?
No, see... My mom has a tendency to hit me over the head when I'm being impolite.
Well, she either knocked sense India or out of you. I don't know which. Now, you need to learn to behave.
I'll try, but sometimes I misbehave when I'm not even trying.
Listen, fella, you're not going to change the world like that. You need to straighten up. Straighten up. Get a job. Do you have a job? Get a job.
Well, you give my best to that pretty as a princess auntie of yours. What a beaut.
Walt headed over to the hotel as fast as he could. He was awfully excited to tell his auntie the good news. He felt like a steam engine coming down the track. Then he was barreling up those stairs as fast as he could. Suddenly he was grinning and knocking loudly at the door. He wanted to tell his auntie. He wanted to tell the whole world.
Robert. Hey, Walter. Auntie, you're never going to believe it. They're paying me to draw pictures. I got a job at Pessman Rubin. They're paying me $50 a month. I'm a real artist now. And it's all because of you.
Who is it, Robert?
Andy Margaret, it's me, Walt.
It's our nephew, Margaret. Elias' son. Walter.
Who is it? I don't understand.
Auntie Margaret, it's your favorite nephew. It's Walt. I mean, you gave me my tablet, my drawing supplies. And if it wasn't for your encouragement, I wouldn't be an artist. I mean, you used to rave about all my pictures.
I'm tired. I think I'm gonna sleep for a while.
I'm sorry, Walt. Margaret isn't feeling well. Perhaps you should come back another day.
I don't understand. Auntie Margaret, it's me, Walter. You can't get spared. The artist.
Walt, please. Come here. Margaret is really sick now. The doctor says that she's fighting off pneumonia. Now, she's been getting... forgetful lately. Please, don't take it personally.
Surely she would remember me if I could just talk to her for one
minute.
Walt,
I'm really sorry. Truly, I am. But I'm going to have to ask you to leave. Margaret needs her rest. You understand.
I just want to thank her for encouraging me to draw.
Walt, please. Please don't make this any more difficult than it already is.
Oh, gosh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be a trouble. I just... Is it okay if I say goodbye? I mean, please give me that. I'll be quick. I just want to say goodbye.
Sure, sure. Go ahead.
Thank you. Good seeing you.
It's good to see you too, Walter. Give my best to Olan.
Who is that, Robert?
No one, dear. No one.
The next few months were tough on Walt. His auntie passed away from pneumonia. He never really got to convey to her just how grateful he was. He never got to feel her old enthusiasm about his talent, the enthusiasm that gave him the confidence to pursue his dreams in the first place. And he lost his job at Pestman Rubin due to downsizing. Things were looking pretty bleak for Walt, but he didn't lose faith. He knew he had a God-given talent, and it was meant for something special. Elias was right. He was the dreamer, and dreamers never quit.
Hey, Walt, it's me, the donut-eating champion of Pesman Rubin. Ub! Ub Iwerks! Jump aboard Coke, Captain!
Ub, old buddy, old pal. Come to offer me my job back? I gotta say, I got a lot of prospects on the horizon. No, I got kicked out on my rear, too. That's why I came by. Thought maybe you had something, anything. I gotta support my mother, and she's not the most gentle mother, if you know what I mean. So I didn't know if you had something. I'm desperate, Walt. Desperate, I tell ya. I didn't know if maybe with your connections with your brother Roy, if you had something. Anything. I'm gonna be honest, Hub. I don't have much going on myself. Come on, Walt. If anybody can think of something, it's you. You're a thinker. I've got your number. You've got one of the greatest minds in all the world. If you just put your mind to it, you'll think of something. All right, calm down. You're gonna wake the neighbors. Daylight, Walt. Some of them take naps, but I can't think with you being a big bundle of nerves. Now give me a second to think about it. Right, sorry. If I just let you think, then we can come up with something. Think. A minute. All right, a minute. Right.
Can you breathe a little quieter?
Not really my fault. The doctor says when I get all stressed, my sinuses and nasal cavities flare up, and I don't know what's going on. If I could just think with Pesman Rubin and...
By Jove, I think I got it.
Got what?
An idea, Up, an idea.
Oh, what is it?
We go into business for ourselves.
I don't think so.
We don't need an agency. We cut out the middleman. It's just us. All we need is clients. We can call it... Iwerks Disney, commercial artist.
You're gonna give me top billing.
Well, Disney Iwerks sounds like you're gonna get your eyes checked out. Or get a nice pair of spectacles. We're commercial artists, we're not optometrists. I tell you what, you go set up shop, I'll get the clients, we'll be in business in no time. Well, what are you doing? Get going!
Right. Yes, sir, Mr. Disney, sir. Walt, sir. Walt Disney, sir.
Now, Walt and Ub weren't doing too bad at all. Walt did the sales pitches and got enough clients to afford them their own office and plenty of profit. The Iwerks Disney Commercial Artist Company was in business all right. Well, for a little while anyway. You see, Walt got a job as an animation cartoonist at the Kansas City Slide Company, and he left Ub in charge of their company. Ub wasn't much of a take-charge kind of guy. Things went downhill pretty fast. And soon enough, Ub was asking Walt if he could get a job at the Kansas City Slide Company too. So that was the end of the Iwerks Disney Commercial Artist Company and the beginning of learning a new kind of drawing, animation. How it began might seem a bit primitive, but remember, you have to start somewhere. So first, an animator draws a picture. Then they cut out whatever parts are going to move. And they tap those movable pieces onto a board with a little pin. Snap a picture, move the piece a tiny bit, pin it again, snap a picture, move the piece again. Well, you get the picture. Now, this is how they ran the animation department where Walt worked at the Kansas City Slide Company. But he'd heard of a new kind of animation. Cell animation. It was a whole lot more creative, a whole lot more inventive, a whole lot more Walt Disney.
Wow, like we don't know the place.
Roy, I'm going to make magic in here. I borrowed this camera from Mr. Cogger, and I'm going to be making cell animation. It's the hottest thing out in New York right now. It's going to revolutionize the way animated films are made.
Well, it's not what Elias had in mind when he built this garage, but I'm sure he'd be impressed to see him making moving pictures in here.
Yeah. I'm onto something big here, Roy. I can feel it. It's so modern and exciting. And I'm good at it, Roy. I'm good at it.
No, you're good at it. You're good at anything you put your mind to, but can you make something out of this? I mean, if you can make some money at this, some real money, you should open a business.
Roy, old brother of mine, you're talking to somebody who's already procured himself an interview with the King of Kansas City Showbiz.
Frank Newman?
Yeah, Frank L. Newman, the owner of the Newman Theater on Main Street, seating 1,000 seats in Italian Renaissance style. I illustrated their programs when I worked at Pessim Rubin, so I already had an in. I told them about the laughgrams me and the fellows were working on, and they liked the idea. Said Mr. Newman would love to see him.
And what's a laughgram, exactly?
Well, you know how before a movie begins, they show a few minutes of a newsreel?
Yeah, sure.
Well, it's just like that, but with moving cartoons. Okay, just imagine, like, a commentary on something that's happening in the city. You know how everybody complains about the transportation being so slow. Well, we show a lady sitting there, waiting for our trolley, and the next thing you know, a flower's growing up around her hosiery.
Yeah? Huh? Here, show me.
All right, you only have to paint the background once, okay? Anything that moves is put on the forefront of a transparent celluloid. But if only one character's talking, and the other's standing still, you only have to move one character. And then you just use a stationary cell for the other. Here, let me show you.
That's really something.
I think I'm gonna be in business again. And if these laughgrams take off, I can start making longer films. Whole animated films. One for kids and adults. And a whole family to see together.
I'll let you know what I'm waiting for you. So, did you finish this one?
Yeah. It's perfect.
Now, these are the bee's knees, Mr. Disney. I mean it.
Say, we could do one where bees have knees. That would be a laugh, wouldn't it be?
Ain't that the truth? Well, I love them.
Love them.
Yeah, love them. Gotta have them.
Gotta have them.
Right here, right now. That's what you come here for, ain't it?
Yes, sir. Yeah, it is.
Now, tell me how much you want for these here laughograms. Are they going to be too expensive to produce, or can I buy them from you?
Oh, gosh. Well,
Are you telling me that you came to a business meeting and you don't have a sales pitch? What is this, your first time around the block, kid?
No. Of course not. It's just, I have a frog in my throat. That's it.
Well, you tell him to jump on out here and give me a price. I ain't got all day.
30 cents a foot.
Deal. Come on, I'll check on it. Mr. Disney, I believe that this is going to be the beginning of a beautiful relationship.
Sure is, sir. Sure is. And thanks for watching this and giving me the time to...
Kid, I ain't got all day. Save your mush for your gal and move on up.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
This is not the military. My name's Mr. Newman. The door's over there.
Right. Get it.
Thanks, Mr. Newman.
Enough already. Get out of here before I change my offer.
Now, Walt left that meeting with Mr. Newman feeling like $1 million. Until he realized he wasn't going to make any money on the deal. He was so excited to have sold his laughograms to the King of Kansas City Showbiz that he forgot to figure in his profit on the pricing. Oh, well, Walt wasn't discouraged. He had a new office space for he and the fellas, his employees, to work out. Plus, they'd gone out and gotten a Model T to ride around in and drum up business. They even already had a few clients and investors trickling in. Enough that Walt felt inspired. And when Walt felt inspired, well, he was still working on it long after everybody else went home.
Why, hello there. You know there's a cat that prowls around these parts, right? But don't worry, if you stay with me,
I'll keep you safe. Just as long as I feed you, huh? Well, I didn't know I was talking to a business mouse. Well, I'm happy to have the company. You know, since we're newly acquainted friends, I should probably tell you, I'm gonna change the world. It all starts right here. I know a lot of people say that, but, you know, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna do it. Go ahead and finish that. I got work to do.
Alice's Wonderland was one of the first films to have live-action characters appear inside a cartoon and interact with animated characters.
All right, Virginia, come over here and sit down. I want you to look at my drawing pad here. You're not going to see anything. But I want you to imagine. You have an imagination, right?
Yes, sir.
You sure?
Yes.
It's not broken or anything, is
it? No, sir, I was imagining last night for today, and I was supposed to be sleeping, but my mother got mad.
Oh, well, I hope we meet your expectations. So, Virginia, for this scene, I want you to look at my drawing pad and imagine that there's a doghouse, okay?
Okay.
There's this scuffle going on inside, okay? And the dog keeps getting thrown out.
By who?
Well, at the end, you find out that there's a cat living inside.
That's silly.
Well, then you don't have to imagine anything at all. Just remember what I told you and about how silly it is. And just think about how it makes you laugh, and then just laugh, okay?
Okay.
Hold on, Virginia. Fred, can you answer that, please? He's got it, Walt! Can you tell him to hang it up and leave it off the hook so we don't get any more interruptions?
Sure thing, Walt!
Hey, can I talk to you for a minute, Walt? Sorry, Virginia. Hey, you want to see my pet mouse?
Yes.
Hey, show her the mouse. Where'd it go?
I think it's over here.
Oh, I see him. There you go. There's a mouse. All right, what is it, Fred?
It was a bank. Well, they said we bounced our last 20 checks, including payroll. They're adding interest and fees. I mean, it's pretty bad. Do you know anybody that could help us out? I mean, one of your investor friends, maybe?
No. I don't have any more investors. We're all dried up, Fred. I tell you what, let's continue working on Alice's Wonderland with Virginia. You know, we've already invested so much in this, all right? And I'll drum up some more business, all right? I promise I will.
Sure, Walt. It's just, well, me and the guys, we gotta eat and all, and with our checks bouncing.
Yeah, I feel awful about that, Fred. To you and the guys, you know? Just, let's take a break and order some lunch from the diner downstairs, all right?
Walt.
I didn't know buts, all right? I insist.
But what do you want me to pay him with?
Yeah.
Cartoons?
Yeah.
This is your money now, Walt.
If there's any leftover, you split between you and the guys, all right?
What are you gonna do?
Don't worry about me, all right? Now go on. I gotta get back to Virginia.
Now, if there's anything that Walt Disney believed in, it was his talent. Whether that talent was art or being the best salesman the world had ever known, he must have hit up every client he'd ever worked with in his entire career, plus all the ones he'd never worked with. He was going to find a way to save Laugh-O-Gram Studios and his friend, even if it drove him into the ground. See, all of his employees, the fellas, they believed in Walt and his talent and vision, too. So he just couldn't give up. Not ever. And good thing, too, because someone somewhere heard about it and sent Mr. McCrum Walt's way.
So I get these financial grants, about $500 each, to do educational films, and, we'd like Laugh-O-Gram to do one.
I'm interested.
Good. It's called Tommy Tucker's Tooth. It's for the Diener Dental Institute of Kansas City.
Okay, what's the premise? What do you want to teach these kids? Like, how to brush their teeth?
In a manner of speaking, yes. Well, let's assume you have an open position and you've got two equally qualified prospective employees. Now, one has bad teeth, one has good teeth. Which do you choose?
Because it depends on the personalities, I suppose.
Sure. But, well, let's assume that they are identical in every way except for their teeth. Now, one has pristine pearly whites, and the other one has decayed and rotting ones.
I see your point.
Mm-hmm. See, Tommy Tucker takes care of his teeth, and Jimmy Jones doesn't. We hope to teach the children the importance of dental hygiene.
Okay, I'm in.
Good.
Well, we'll continue our discussion at the Institute.
Can we talk here?
Mr. Dizzy, I've assembled a team at the Institute. I think you'll find it helpful to gather the information you need there and sign the paperwork.
Boy, this is embarrassing.
Is there a problem, Mr. Disney?
You can call me Walt. It's just these are hard times, Mr. McCrum, and...
That they are, Walt. That they are.
Well, it's just I have one pair of shoes, you see, and... They're at the cobbler right now, and... I don't have $1.50 to get it back.
Not a problem at all, Walt. Well, as a matter of fact, I live just down the street from the cobbler. How about this? I'll drop you off, retrieve your shoes, and then I'll pick you up for the meeting.
Gosh, Mr. McCrum, I'll pay you back, I promise. I mean, you can take it out of my salary for the project.
Not a problem at all, Walt. Let's consider it one good Christian helping another.
That's awful nice of you, Mr. McCrum. It's awful nice.
Well, shall we?
Walt was thrilled to have a job of any kind, and this one went really well. He liked working with the children involved in Tommy Tucker's tooth. Sure, the pay wasn't great, but it seemed like a great payoff anyway, on account of it was educational, and it would help children to take care of their teeth. Walt felt like he had done something good, but nobody had been paid in a long while now. So Walt doled out the cash to everyone but himself again, figuring what goes around comes around. Hoping that something good would come back to him, he had faith that God would provide. But, he kind of wanted to eat, too. Times were tough at Laugh-O-Gram. Clients were scarce. Bills were mounting. But Walt tried pressing on. He'd been borrowing money here and there, trying other ways to make a buck, even advertising to take baby pictures and even pet pictures. The guys always kept each other in good spirits. Kept each other laughing and smiling, but laughs and smiles don't pay the bills. Soon the collectors... Well, they came knocking, and a-knocking, and a-knocking.
Yes, I was here yesterday, and the day before that, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, I remember you. Didn't you eat the last jelly donut?
No, I most certainly did not. I'm looking for a Mr. Dinsey.
Dinsey? No, Dinsey.
Next door, maybe.
Did you try Kansas City? Kansas?
I know very well Mr. Dinsey signed papers to incorporate this Laugh-O-Gram Studios. He hasn't paid his creditors, and he needs to take care of that right away. Right away, I tell you!
So tell me, what would happen to this poor old Mr. Dinsey if he didn't take care of such matters?
Well, it would be very bad. Very bad indeed.
Yeah, well, if it means a visit by you every day, I would have to agree.
This is no laughing matter, sir.
But you admit he signed paperwork for Laugh-O-Gram Studios.
Oh, now you're just trying to ruffle my feathers, aren't you?
Listen, Mr...
That's none of your business, sir.
Right, well, I bet Mr. Dinsey, just like the rest of us post-war workers, is probably a little bit down on his luck right now. So chin up, and I'm sure he'll pay his bills in no time. No time at all.
And might I get your name, sir?
Well, it's sure not Mr. Dinsey. And I surely hope that we don't ever meet again.
Oh, you'll see me tomorrow.
What a perfect way to spend my day.
Say, Walt, do we have any of those jelly donuts left? What? Did Ubi eat them again?
So you are, in fact, Mr. Dinsey.
No. Mr. Disney. If you're going to say it right.
The Laugh-O-Gram studio business was going downhill fast. Walt did everything he could to save it. Things looked dismal. Walt just couldn't seem to turn things around. But it sure wasn't for lack of trying. It's just that tunes, before movies, only made up about 2% of the theater business. That finished Mr. Newman's dealings with Walt. But the roughest thing to face wasn't the possibility of losing Laugh-O-Gram Studio. It was the possibility of losing his brother.
Sam? Yeah. I was hoping I wouldn't wake you. I just got back from work.
He's getting back? You need to take better care of yourself.
Listen to you. Looking after me even when you're doing terrible.
I'll admit, I've seen better days. Come on in. I need to talk to you for a minute.
You know I'm leaving tomorrow, don't you? Doc says warmer climate better for me. Yeah, I figured tuberculosis in the war. These Missouri winters haven't exactly been too kind to me.
Yeah.
I thought I'd see more of you before I left.
I've just been working, you know.
It's okay. Well, you don't have to be afraid.
Afraid of what?
Afraid I'm gonna die?
Don't say that, Roy.
If it's my time, then by the grace of God, I'll go. I'm not scared.
Well, I'm scared, you know? I mean, I don't know what I'd do without you. I can't lose you, Roy. I just can't. You're the only one around here who... You're the only one around here who understands me, and... Maybe I'm selfish, but I'm not ready. I'm not. I'm not going to say goodbye.
I am always going to be with you, even through life and death. You can talk to me anytime you want. When you're scared or need advice or support, I'm not going to leave you. Maybe here if that's what the good Lord has planned, but... It's never goodbye. Not really.
Look at me. Looking to you for some kind of solace when you're the one in need. Get some rest. I want you to get better.
Yeah. I'm working on it. I've been praying on it every day.
Me too. Hey, Roy. Just in case I don't get to see you. I know I love you, right?
I love you too. But I'm not going anywhere. At least not tonight.
After Roy left for a warmer climate, the rest of the family followed suit. Walt had never known a time when he hadn't been surrounded by family, but for the first time in his life, he felt entirely alone. He felt lost. Just when he needed the support of his family the most, they had all left. It was the saddest time in his life. Walt was always the innovator, and Ub the artist. Maybe that's why he never gave up. He just couldn't. His mind never ran out of ideas. But he did run out of money.
Walt, you okay?
Oh, way up. Yeah. Just working on the Alice film. You want to help?
Wish I could, Walt. I've got a job. I just came by on my lunch break and thought I could tell you in person. I'm resigning. I'm really sorry, Walt, but, I need the money. You understand, don't you?
It's okay, I understand.
You're living here, Walt?
Sleeping here, yeah. Spend most of my time here anyway.
Is anybody else working here?
No, just me. And, my friend here. People have to make money, and it's just something I don't have to give right now.
What are you living on, Walt?
Not much. Not much, Ab.
How's Roy doing? Has he gotten any better?
Yeah, he's getting better. Well enough to badger me about how to run things around here. He thinks I should file for bankruptcy and move out to California. Animation's bigger out there and says there's a real market for it. But I made a commitment with the Alice film. And I think I'm going to try to finish it.
I think you should listen to your brother, Walt. Hey, I've got to get back.
What's that for?
I just want you to have something to eat. Goodbye, Walt.
Maybe Walt felt a little like Alice. Lions chomping at his heels, nothing he could do. This was the end of the line for sure. He had filed for bankruptcy. He pawned his camera so he could buy a train ticket to California to be with Roy, to start again. In a lot of ways, he felt like he was jumping off a cliff to avoid the ferocious lions waiting to eat him up.
I don't want to leave you in there to get eaten by that cat. You'll have a better chance out here. You'll see. It's like my friend Doc Sherwood said when I was a kid. Sometimes you gotta give up on the things that you love. Sometimes it makes sense to move on. It hurts me too, but there's a whole world out there for you to see. You don't want to be in the same place for the rest of your life, do you? Just think of the adventures you're going to be missing out on. It's time to go for the both of us. Goodbye, little fellow. See you real soon.
No matter how bleak things seemed, Walt Disney never gave up. Not once. Failure upon failure, he still believed in himself, in his talents, the faith in his soul that he could achieve anything if he just put his mind to it. After all he'd been through, he still went on towards life's next adventure, and thank goodness he did. He went on to become someone so special, so innovative, so remarkable. Walt Disney went on to become a pioneer in the art of entertainment, spreading joy throughout the world, creating magnificent dreams in the minds of children everywhere, filling hearts with happiness. While without this man, the world would have a lot less smiles. You see, dreamers never quit. Dreamers do.
Can chase away a dark sky.